and welcome to the Hans Brinker Leadership Series, Extraordinary Leaders in Extraordinary Times by Adi Partners. I am Sanjay Vishwanathan.
I am Hiral Desai. We've had some amazingly insightful discussions on the show and an overwhelming response from all our viewers. So thank you all for watching us.
In our previous episodes, we have spoken to champions from healthcare, nonprofit, industry, and hospitality sectors. Today, we have a champion from the energy space. Let me introduce you to Tarun Mehta, co-founder Aether Energy. Tarun and his co-founder Swapnil Jain dreamt up building an energy platform around a battery rather than the other way around while at IIT Madras. Today, they have India's best-in-class battery-powered scooter, the Aether 450X, the only high-performance battery in India that's developed completely in-house.
In 5 short years, Tarun and Swapnil are leading the growth of an entire two-wheeler ecosystem with world-class battery platform, IoT software where two-wheelers is a device, supply chain, charging infrastructure, and innovative financing. They are a shining example of Make in India at its best. Delighted to have you in cohort of champions on the Hans Brinker Leadership Series. Welcome to the cohort, Tarun.
Hey, thanks for having me over here.
Thanks. A pleasure is all ours, Tarun. My first question coming to you is, if you could just tell us a bit more about your background, what inspired you to actually come ahead and find Aether Energy and not Aether Scooters?
Right. So I'm from Ahmedabad. Grew up in Ahmedabad, Gujarat till my 12th standard. Then got admitted to IIT. So went to IIT Madras, Chennai. Was in the 5-year dual degree program there. Met my co-founder Swapnil in IIT. We started calling the two of us as Aether Energy way back in our second year of college. We were very excited by the energy. The entire industry, everything from generation, distribution to storage and application. Obviously, as two undergrad students, though we named ourselves Aether Energy, it was pretty hard for us to start up. So we tried a lot of things, but it was pretty hard to actually get them to market. So post graduation, we both left, went different ways, took up different jobs. But literally within a few months, we hit upon an idea to build battery packs, lithium ion battery packs. And these battery packs were meant for electric vehicles. And that took us down this rabbit hole of trying to figure out what's really happening with electric vehicles in India. This is the same time that Tesla was introducing Model S in US. So there was obviously a lot of excitement and conversation around electric that was on everywhere. So we started doing our own research and quickly came to a couple of conclusions. We met a lot of people who had bought electric scooters. And our conclusions were that there are a lot of customers already in the market who are very, very excited and very keen to buy electric. They believe that this is the future of automotives. But almost all of them are unanimously unexcited or actually disappointed in the products that exist on the road today. So there was a very clear opportunity to build a good electric vehicle. What was wrong with the products? Well, most of the products were imports from China. And what was working in China was not going to work in India. China electric vehicle market was very different at a very different price point with a lot of government bans and supports and all kind of forcing the market in a particular way. India being a democracy was never going to follow that route. Second, that was a product opportunity. The second thing that we were excited by was the development opportunity. We realized that very few people will build new technology from scratch in India. It's the entire Indian automotive market has had decades worth of reliance on IP and joint ventures from outside the country. And electric is such a big leap. It's like 100x harder than going from BS4 to BS6. And even for BS4 to BS6, we need a lot of MNCs to bring in a lot of technology, integration, manufacturing, IP to India. So going electric was not going to happen that easily locally. And that's the other opportunity. We said, listen, we can build a fantastic product and that we should build a fantastic product. But the second thing we should do it, we should build it in India. If we can bring together a very strong R&D team, if we can create a lot of IP in here, we can build a fantastic engine of an organization that can start churning out electric vehicles at a crazy pace in India. India is the largest two-wheeler market in the world, and if you could start from there and build IP, build teams, build products here, I think we have an almost impossible to stop combo. So that's how things began.
Right. That's an interesting story so far, Tarun, that we hear. And, you know, even though you've been an early entrant with regards to where the EV market in India goes, you have been up against formidable competition. What makes you different and what makes you sustainable?
Unlike everybody else in the automotive world, we don't have any legacy investments on the petrol side, whether it is engines, whether it is transmissions, whether it is fuel, exhaust, and any of that. So that keeps us light in some sense. We don't have to worry about cannibalizing our businesses because our only business is 100% electric. Second, we are born into a 100% electric and connected world. So, and this is true for globally. Electric vehicles lend themselves really well to connected vehicles. Given the entire powertrain, the entire technology that goes inside an electric battery and a motor and a controller, you already have all the data there to actually have a connected vehicle experience. So we don't have legacy investments. We don't have to worry about cannibalizing ourselves. And we are one of the few companies that can actually build out not just electric, but actually a connected vehicle ecosystem right from scratch. Third thing, we're not thinking like an OEM. So we're not just looking at, okay, how do we build products, manufacture them and sell them? We're thinking of an entire ecosystem that is coming up because of electric. So for example, we've been building out our own charging infrastructure. Typically something like charging infrastructure would not be handled by OEMs, and OEMs would partner with other players who will then have a really complicated handshake arrangement. Multiple partnerships will have to be struck across different geographies to get infrastructure out across the country. We think if you're going electric, you will have to lead the way on infrastructure also. Infrastructure, batteries, automotive is all tightly linked in the electric world. So we've been born this world, we're thinking that way, which is why we're building out our own infrastructure. We have already 50 fast charging points. We are the only ones in the country to do that. And we're rolling out hundreds more over the next 2 years. So between legacy, between connected products, and thinking of an entire ecosystem, whether it is software, whether it is charging, we are reasonably different from a typical OEM today.
During lockdown 1.0, Tarun, several sectors bore the brunt of migrant labor issues and supply chain disruption. What was the impact on Aether and how did you ride it?
So COVID hit everybody badly. It impacted our labor as much as it impacted the supply chain also. So in our case, there was almost a 2 month worth of a lockdown directly in Bangalore, in some cases a few weeks longer. Many of our suppliers, however, were impacted for much longer. I remember all the way till June, some of our suppliers were still shut down. So there was almost a three and a half month impact on the supply chain. And given the really interconnected nature of automotive supply chains, if even one partner is shut down, everything is comes to a standstill. So the overall impact, I would say about a quarter worth of an offset on our plans. But we have largely recovered. Actually, we are completely recovered now. Our factory is back to running at full capacity now. Our suppliers have been able to get back to full capacity. In fact, they've been able to catch up on some of their line losses over the last quarter or so. So things are looking much better. And I think come the festival season, the automotive industry would have completely bounced back.
The pandemic has significantly eroded consumers' purchasing power, and we foresee demand for consumer vehicles taking a dip in the short term. How do you propose to be resilient and stimulate demand?
So I think electric vehicles are starting at such a small base today. We are such an early stage of the entire sector growth that demand is not realistically going to be a real challenge over the next few years. I think key challenges for everybody in the EV world, all new players like Aether and everybody else, I think a key challenge in the next year or two is really distribution and getting people to experience the products. Most customers across most cities haven't even heard about electric. Forget about actually experiencing a good electric product. So I would worry about big things like stimulating demand. If I was running a large automotive company, legacy automotive company, which was dealing with saturating demand and you know, completely maxed out distribution. Today we have present in two cities. The challenge for Aether is not how do we get demand going in these two cities. The challenge for Aether is how do we open up 100 more cities in India over the next year. So really, that's where our focus is. It's less about demand, creating demand, more about ensuring that we have enough supply and we are present, we have enough distribution.
Right. And then, you know, I understand that, you know, distribution is the major challenge right now as well. And, you know, with this, what's happening is that the country is grappling with the virus. The global recession is something which is also a cause of concern for businesses. However, for your sector, do you see that there is a silver lining probably in these dark times?
So, if I have to look at a few silver linings, automotive sector is one of the last ones which is moving digital. So much of the purchase has moved online, but automotive is one of those places which has yet to really move online. Online is more about marketing yet than actual sales. But I think because of the pandemic, more and more of the steps towards the actual purchase and decision making are going to move online. So for new brands like us, already 60-70% of our demand came online. And I think because of the pandemic, this is a trend that's only going to accelerate. So the reason I believe we are fundamentally resilient is because our primary channel anyways was online, something that's not shut down in something like the pandemic, and it's not going to be impacted despite any future lockdowns. And I think for the entire industry, this is a trend that will accelerate. And the silver lining for us is that we've been able to make some of the early steps already in that direction.
Right. And talking about this, you know, I mean, I track automobiles as a sector pretty closely. I was reading a report written by, you know, Rocky Mountain Institute, where they are projecting that electric two-wheelers and three-wheelers probably will account for at least 80% of all the passenger vehicles sold in India by 2030. If this is the kind of demand that we are going to see for EVs going ahead, what is going to be Aether's strategy to be the market leaders in this segment? And what's the kind of market share that you are looking to garner then?
I think market shares are also, I think it's hard to sort of explain the kind of change that's coming in front of us over the next few years. And I think percentage conversations make sense at a far more mature stage for the industry. Today, we are at a place where literally the entire sector is selling like 100,000 vehicles every year. Our target for the next 12 to 18 months is going to be 100,000 units. Does that mean that we are going to be 100% of the market? No. I would be surprised if the rest of the market does not grow along with it. I think the next 5 to 7 years is going to be a times of almost 100% CAGR for the entire EV market. Specifically the electric two-wheeler market. I think the electric two-wheeler market has the potential to grow to almost 10 million units over the next 10 to 12 years. Starting from a base of 100,000 units to grow to 10 million over a decade, I can't even do the math of, you know, what kind of a CAGR that is. That's huge. Our strategy is very simple. We're starting from the premium segments. So we want to make sure that we can build a fantastic experience and convince customers that electric is very real, electric is very exciting. Open up 20-30 cities in the next 8-10 months, get enough distribution going, and with this as a starting point, create more and more products across multiple price points, and eventually compete with the mass market players also. But this will take a couple of years, but it's coming in the next, it's coming very soon.
Though there is immense potential, what factors are impeding the momentum for EVs, and how can Aether address this?
So I think the big challenge coming in front of EV adoption, it's not the biggest challenge yet, but if you look at a 2-year timeline, I think this will be a big challenge in front of the entire industry, is charging infrastructure. And not charging infrastructure the way, let's say, the US market would think of it. We're not talking about how we have petrol bunks, where are giant, large charging stations out in the public. That's not going to happen. The bulk of the EV the bulk of the EV market in India is going to be electric two-wheelers, and 95% plus, maybe even 98% of the charging is going to happen in your homes, in your parking lots, not in petrol bunks or electric bunks outside. So public charging is going to be a minuscule percentage of the overall charging requirement. It's going to be crucial, but that's a solvable problem, something we're already doing. The biggest problem is going to be getting charging in your houses. Now, and the funny thing is, and which is why it's not an insurmountable problem, of all the commodities that you can think of, electricity is one of is the most accessible commodity across the entire country. Like literally almost every single pillar in your parking has a cable running through it. You have proper structured metering, you have trays in your you have infrastructure, you have everything to get charging, to get access to electricity in your parking lots. But the limiting step right now is that we don't have chargers. We don't have authenticated power supply in your parking lots. Now, that's not a problem in every single customer's case, especially the early adopters. But as we go beyond the top 3, 4, 5% of the market, as we start looking at converting 10, 20, 30% of the market, this will become a very real challenge. And this is a place where I think good government support, not just support, good government, good laws can actually crack through this problem very quickly. This is something I've been championing for a while. We need central laws to sort of mandate setting up of just 15 amp sockets in every single parking lot. If just access to electricity is assured, I think the market will change dramatically over the next few years. Every time we say charging infrastructure needs to be solved, the government goes down the wrong direction of saying, oh, okay, let's issue a tender for 500 charging points on highways. I'm like, nobody's going on a highway and nobody's going to, like, we don't really need to solve the problem of public charging. A private company can solve the problem of public charging. That's ridiculously easy. Ather is solving it, or 50 different companies will solve it. The problem that the government really needs to focus on is home charging, because that needs laws, that needs legislation. So that's the thing to solve.
The automotive industry is in the midst of huge technological disruption. How do you think intelligent vehicles will revolutionize our commute experience in the future?
So I think apart from the, like, as vehicles start going electric, one very obvious thing that's happening, and I said it at the start of the conversation also, is that vehicles will become smarter, vehicles will all go connected, and specifically with the dropping price of connectivity, it's a natural trend for all vehicles that's going to happen. Now, once you have vehicles which are connected and vehicles which are electric, what this will lead to is a wide variety of different interesting and innovative business models that couldn't exist in the petrol vehicle world. So, for example, something as simple as lease, which exists for cars, but never existed for scooters or bikes. Why? Because it's so hard to secure that asset, right? So how will a financier own the asset and lease it out if there is no way to track it, control it, and it's such a low purchase price product? But the minute you introduce connectivity and the minute you introduce control on the entire powertrain, because it's electric, it gives a ton more comfort to financiers to enter into leasing for electric two-wheelers and electric vehicles in general. So I think leasing will become a far bigger part of sales tomorrow. Something similar will happen with subscriptions. If leasing is possible, then people will take that business model and they will break it into bite-sized pieces. Let's say an annual subscription or a quarterly subscription or a daily subscription or literally an hourly usage pack, right? And we will, I think, see a proliferation of companies that will basically operate at this layer, which is enabling access to customers on a different time scale basis. Now, which is not possible unless you talked about taxis in the past. But now imagine you could do that with two-wheelers on literally a hourly, minute, kilometer, all of those different bases. It's a model that people are obviously experimenting with today, the bike taxi companies and everybody. But it's incredibly hard to do, and with near zero attractive margins if you do it with petrol vehicles. It's very hard to scale that across the country. The minute you move to electric and connected vehicles, these business models start flying off in a big way. If that happens, I think you will see the penetration, or you will not see a penetration increase of the number of people who own vehicles, but the number of people who use two-wheelers could skyrocket. So today we have about 20%, 20-25% of the population that is actually using a two-wheeler in India today. Imagine if that number were to match something like what happens in Indonesia, which is 100%, 120% penetration. So there's a 5x opportunity to increase access to two-wheelers. Now, it's a long chain, but all of it starts from vehicles going electric. Electric drives connectivity. Connectivity drives new business models. New business models allow an increase in the usage. And that increase in usage is not 10-20%. It can be as much as a 5x increase in usage. And a 5x increase in usage in a country like India is like a huge number we're discussing. So these are some of the things that are definitely bound to happen. The other thing that will happen is because of electric and connected vehicles, technology is going to be moving at a very fast pace, unlike IC engines.
Yeah.
And any industry where technology moves too fast, people will favor upgrades. So look at the mobile world today, right? People upgrade their products every 12 to 18 months. Now, this will change user behavior and this will change purchase behavior in a significant way. Today, I feel that people are actually paying very little to buy a two-wheeler in India, because vehicles are offering them very little. But tomorrow, if you buy a two-wheeler and in 12 to 18 months, you have a new vehicle available, which probably has like a 5x faster processor, a 2x bigger battery, and 10 times faster charging, you will upgrade to a far better experience. Right? So I think we'll see upgrade cycles just completely break through. Like typical ownership cycle in India is about 5-6 years today. Imagine if that crashes down to 12 to 18 months. It'll change the dynamics of the market dramatically. So I think there are a lot of different business models that will open up because of electric and connected vehicles.
Absolutely. So that's going to be a revolution that we're going to see as well in this space overall. And Tarun, in this new normal, you know, we are seeing huge job losses, salary cuts et al. However, you know, younger enterprises are the ones which are actually contributing to society from an economic perspective as well. For Aether, how do you see Aether contributing to the society from an economic perspective? And what's the kind of impact that you're looking to create on industry and society, especially, you know, what roles will be in demand at Aether?
So I think there is a lot of employment that is going to be created in brand new sectors. So, for example, a lot of our manufacturing is going to look a little different than traditional manufacturing, with a lot more electronics content, which is more skilled than just pure mechanical assemblies. We are also seeing our R&D being very different from traditional R&D. Traditional automotive R&D is largely mechanical in nature, maybe 80-90% is mechanical. Electric vehicles injects a very different, like you're going to be basically creating talent around batteries, around power electronics, around digitals, around software in large quantities, firmware, cloud. So I think there is on the R&D side, there is a complete new segment, completely new, like almost 5x bigger team is going to be created. More than just typical mechanical engineering. New architectures, new platforms are going to be built, like down to even freaking frames. Like even frames are going to be rebuilt when we go the electric route. So I think there's a lot of opportunity on the design and R&D side. On manufacturing, servicing, I think there's going to be a massive reskilling that's ahead of us. And the good news is all of this is higher skill. These are all higher skill, they are all on average going to be higher skill jobs than what traditionally existed. So that's what I see ahead in terms of jobs and employment.
And finally, Tarun, what is your advice for budding entrepreneurs? Is there an opportunity to be part of the Aether ecosystem?
Yeah, definitely. We've built a fantastic team, and we look forward to welcoming more people. People who want to build. We would love to have more of you come on board. If you're an entrepreneur and you want to build yourselves, you want to start something new, I think there's a fantastic amount of opportunity on the automotive side now. There's never been so much innovation since maybe last time I think the automotive industry saw such a massive disruption was probably in the 1930s. When Ford was bringing in the Model T, I think the entire industry, because of mass manufacturing, was just seeing an explosion of opportunity. And I think it's almost 1900 years later that we're seeing that kind of a disruption, that kind of an opportunity for new players to come in. So whether it is supply chain, it is building new components like batteries, chargers, or sub parts of those, or it is the software layers which are coming up, whether it is analytics or whether it is control or whether it is enabling connectivity for automotives, or whether it is charging infrastructure or whether it is servicing electric vehicles is going to be so different. The business models are so different. The retail for electric vehicles is going to be so significantly different, with a completely different business model, because unit economics are different. I think there's an opportunity at every single front that you can think of. I think if you are a wannabe entrepreneur, if you're a budding entrepreneur, this is a mind-boggling opportunity to enter the space side.
Absolutely. The kind of changes, the kind of disruption that we're seeing with regards to automation as a sector is huge right now, and great opportunities coming in your way as well. This was an extremely insightful discussion, Tarun. Thank you for sharing with us, and congratulate once again for being the cohort of champions of the Hans Brinker Leadership Series.
Thank you for having me over. It was fun. Thank you.
Indeed, Hero, that was a fascinating insight into automotive and energy industries, the disruptive forces that's reshaping them, and revolutionary advances being led by champions like Tarun Mehta.
Thank you all for tuning in. See you soon.